So what we're going to do, start with the history of U.S. health insurance, then move briefly to macroeconomics. Where do we spend our money in healthcare and where do we get it from? And finally, to compare Medicare, Medicaid, and private health insurance in somewhat of a nauseating but interesting detail. So, to start off, one should realize that, frankly, you know, before 1929, there was functionally no real health insurance in the United States. So this was the time when we spent roughly 1% or less of our gross domestic product on health care. So the question comes up, how did people pay the doctor? Any ideas? If they didn't have health insurance, what did you do?
Cash or barter?
Aha! There. Usually people say just out of pocket cash, right? But I think barter is another way that really did work a lot. People would bring, you know, an apple pie or a chicken to the doctor, right? If they couldn't pay out of pocket. But interestingly, when it came to hospitals, hospitals didn't want those chickens. So how was hospital care compensated for? Any guesses? No health insurance. So what do you think people did?
Did the state pay for it?
Well, it's an interesting question. Probably not in any meaningful way, but people would pay out of pocket, clearly, what they could. But the other way was that there was a lot of charity care, right? That's why you had the Presbyterian Hospital in the city of New York. Presbyterian dealing largely with Protestant patients. Right? That's why you had St. Vincent's, St. Mary's, St. John's Hospitals dealing heavily with Catholic patients. And even in New York City, you had the Mount Sinai's and the Beth Israel's dealing with Jewish patients. So that was one of the major sources of payment for care. But the other was the public hospital system. So it's very interesting here. You've probably heard of H&H. H&H is the public hospital system today. You know, that Lincoln Hospital is one of those, but probably the most famous public hospital. Anyone have a guess?
Bellevue
Hospital, absolutely. How many public hospitals do we have today, do you know, here in New York City? We've got about 10, okay, you know, three here in Manhattan, Bellevue, Harlem, Metropolitan, three in the Bronx, Lincoln, Jacoby, North Central Bronx, three in Queens, I mean, two in Queens, actually. Elmhurst and Queens General, and three, you know, in Brooklyn, Coney Island, Kings County, and yes.
I just wanted to, if I may, add one small point on those religious-affiliated or ethnic-affiliated hospitals. It wasn't just for the patients. Healthcare providers, if you were a Jewish or Catholic healthcare provider, you couldn't get privileges at the Presbyterian Hospital, as it were. So it was for that reason also.
All right, so that there was indeed some discrimination against doctors at that time, no question about it. Okay, well, just to add two things. Back before 1929, how many public hospitals in New York City do you think we had? Was it more or less? Population clearly was smaller back then. Any guess? we had 22 public hospitals in 1929. And I said before that we have 10, we actually have 11 public hospitals. Three in each of the boroughs that I described and two in Queens. So, all right, so what happens after 1929? Does anyone have a guess of what happened in the health insurance sphere? Well, it turns out this is beginning the employment-based health insurance, and in 1929, BC is formed, the Blue Cross. Blue Cross is a nonprofit insurance entity that deals only with hospital care and becomes something that is very, very interesting to unions, right? That during this period of the Depression, unions grew in the United States, and what they wanted were not only wages, but they wanted fringe benefits, and the two fringe benefits that the union wants, one of them would be health insurance, you know, the other is retirement benefits. And I think this is the accident of history where in World War II, health benefits get linked to employment. Unions were not allowed by law to actually bargain for wages during World War II. That would be anti-war effort. But they were allowed to bargain for fringe benefits. And indeed, health care was one of those. And after the war, that's kind of where we stood with, you know, unions having won the benefit of health insurance, wanting to keep it. Then in actually 1946, an entity is created called BS, bullshit. What is BS?
Blue Shield.
Blue Shield. And how does it differ from Blue Cross?
Like out of hospital care, right?
Yeah, it's essentially doctor care, outside laboratories, essentially, you know, nurse practitioner care, what have you, right? And it is also a nonprofit entity. And then what happens is that the IRS comes along and it rules that if the employer contributes to the premium paid for private health insurance, either Blue Cross Blue Shield or a for-profit private insurer, then the employer can deduct that from their taxes. I assume you all know what the IRS is. You're facing it in literally a month from today. So now what you have is an incentive for employers to offer health insurance, because they can deduct the cost of it. And you have, again, workers, unions, pushing to get that benefit. And this is the time that we begin to see commercial life insurance companies, usually for-profit companies, beginning to sell insurance to employers, like Aetna, Cigna, you know, Metropolitan. So what happened in 1965 that changes this landscape?
Medicare.
Ah, somebody that knows the history. Limited forms of health insurance. Medicare, limited to those people over age 65. It was also the year in which Medicaid was formed, limited to people who were poor. And the interesting thing is how these programs were structured. Medicare had a Part A and a Part B. What does Part A cover?
Hospitals.
Hospitalizations. What does Part B cover?
The non-hospital things that are not drugs.
Oh, essentially what Blue Shield covers. Right. But no drug coverage. Absolutely correct back then. And as you learned, you know, no coverage. We'll call closes. No coverage for dental, vision, and hearing. Why that happened is not altogether clear, but it is a phenomenon. And the U.S. remains essentially the only industrialized nation that doesn't have some form of universal access to health care. So then in 1997, something else occurs. Does anyone have an idea of what that would be? This is the Part C of Medicare. Anyone know what that stands for? No.
Is that the Advantage plans, or is that later?
No, the Advantage plans were actually able to start in the 1970s and 80s. But in 1997, Part C is Medicare plus choice. This is where the beneficiary can designate a private health insurance company to manage their health insurance benefit, their Medicare benefit. Okay, and that's significant because really what it is a step towards, and a major step towards, privatization of the public program. And initially, you know, it didn't go that far, you know, until, frankly, 2003, when Medicare Advantage, Part C was renamed, essentially, Medicare Advantage program. Some of us believe it really should have been called Medicare Disadvantage. That is because, in fact, private insurance tends to put up obstacles to, you know, getting care, such as prior approval, you know, dealing with all sorts of denials of care that people go through. There are major hospitals that don't take Medicare Advantage. Do you have any idea of such a hospital in our neighborhood? It turns out Memorial.
No,
we take it. But Memorial does not take Medicare Advantage. Most Medicare Advantage plans, they may take one or two. So this is the period when we go from Part C plus choice to, in 2003, Medicare Advantage. And then in 2006, actually, although it's passed in 2003, but implemented in 2006, we get Part D, which is the drug benefit. And the drug benefit, interestingly, you know, Medicare has to go through a prescription drug benefit management company. So in essence, what happens is that the drug benefit is also privatized, because the prescription drug benefit management company is the one that sets the price and so on. Medicare is prohibited by law from negotiating directly with the pharmaceutical companies for price. And then what we begin to see is, you know, private insurance really begins to do experience rating of premiums, negotiating with employers, you know, if they have a sicker patient population, they have to pay a higher premium. And we really find that private health insurance begins to dominate the market. In fact, interestingly, this particular course, I really wanted everybody to have an experience with an insurance company. So you know, I was able to get Blue Cross Blue Shield, which is a non was a nonprofit back in 1997 when we started this course, residents would spend roughly a week down at Blue Cross Blue Shield. Interesting, Blue Cross Blue Shield was then located in the World Trade Center. And thank God, we did not rotate residents down there the week of 9/11. They were scheduled to go the week after 9/11. Unbelievable, right? But in 2003, Blue Cross Blue Shield in New York State became a for-profit company, and I got a call from the president of the company saying, you know, I'm sorry to say this, but we can no longer have residents come down here. We can no, you know, private health insurance does not pay for residents' salaries. That's something that Medicare does. So the nonprofit Blues converted to for-profit there in 2003. So what happened in 2010? That you all know.
The ACA.
The ACA, right. The Affordable Care Act, and what is it? It's what I call a mandate or market model of health insurance. Everyone, the mandate part, is everyone's required to have health insurance or pay a penalty. You'd have to file, when you filed your W-2, you would have to show that you had health insurance. And if you didn't, as an individual, you would have to pay $969. If you were a family, then I'll leave it closed now because I was, the noise was getting more out there. You'd have to pay $285 on your W-2. If you were an employer that didn't offer health insurance to your employees and had 50 or more employees, so it's not for small businesses, but larger ones, you would have to pay $2,000 per employee in taxes. So that's the mandate part of the legislation. How to pay for health insurance. Medicaid was expanded up to 138% of the federal poverty level. For individuals, that meant $17,236. For a family of three, it was $29,435. And that was very significant here in the state of New York. We were one of the most generous states in terms of Medicaid, but we still insisted that people have incomes below 90% of the federal poverty level. And if you were in Texas or Mississippi, it was between 60 and 70% of the federal poverty level, really poor. And what we got was 2 million more people enrolled in Medicaid because of this increase up to 138% of poverty. But then you still had people who, you know, my God, try living in New York City on $17,000. So there were still a whole bunch of poor people between 138 and 400% of the poverty level. And what they decided to do was, in fact, to create these insurance exchanges or marketplaces where the federal government would help subsidize your premium so you could buy private for-profit health insurance. And then finally, there were all these market-based reforms, coverage up to age 26 on your parents' policy. Some of you might have taken advantage of that, who knows? 10 standards that all private health insurance had to maintain, and no pre-existing condition exclusions and no lifetime limits on private health insurance. What was the common pre-existing condition exclusion? in many places where you would change, let's say you went to a new job, you asked for health insurance, they said, well, we can only get you the health insurance after 9 months. 9 months? Why 9 months? Any
pregnancy.
Idea?
Pregnancy, all right.
What pre-existing condition, right, exists for 9 months? It is pregnancy. Because in fact, you know, what happened is that a lot of young people, thinking they were invincible, didn't get health insurance. But then they got pregnant and they knew they needed it. But if they were changing jobs, they might not in fact be able to get health insurance.
Or if they had asthma, or if they had a prior cancer, or anything else.
Well, sometimes, it depends. This is the structure of the, ACA. What we've talked about is health insurance reform, expansion of Medicaid, creation of exchanges, guaranteed issue, no pre-existing conditions, kids up to 26, better coverage, rate reviews of Medicare Advantage, prevention benefits, prescription drugs, but a whole bunch of other things here. Creation of accountable care organizations, new arrangements for dual eligibles, Medicare and Medicaid, care transitions when people went from hospital to nursing home, value-based payment, everything. The creation of this thing called the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation. We'll talk a little more about that in a moment. All the way down to FQHCs, Federally Qualified Health Centers. Little wonder that a new president in 2017, who wanted to repeal the ACA, to get rid of it, did come out and admit, no, I never realized how complicated the ACA really is. And so, what did he do? We went through a period of the Trump administration from 2017 to 2020, tried to repeal the ACA, but it failed legislatively. But he used executive orders to undercut the ACA, and he eliminated the insurance mandate. How did he do that? It got embodied within the tax reduction. Do you remember the one on the wealthy? From 35% down to 21%. Okay, tucked into that, which I think most legislators didn't fully realize, was that we won't, in fact, fine people, for not having health insurance. So the mandate was technically removed. Then he shifted private health insurance standards to the states, allowing them to set up pre-existing conditions if they wished, allowed states to set income eligibility for Medicaid to CHIP below the 138% of the poverty level. This was an issue that went all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said the federal government couldn't force the states to pay for Medicaid. They cut federal aid to Planned Parenthood. We all know what the consequences of that have been. And in terms of COVID response, we did at least do some rapid vaccine development. So very briefly, in terms of the Biden health proposals, he maintained the COVID-19 response with some free vaccination and free home testing. He tried through the Build Back Better Act, which is still not passed Congress, but has been shrunk from, $3 trillion down to less than one. He tried to, deal with private health insurance expansion through ACA exchanges to improve the traditional Medicare coverage by including dental, vision, and hearing benefits, and he tried to implement, out-of-pocket limits and drug price control within Medicare. And, you know, just recently he got into privatizing the traditional Medicare program by supporting a Trump program that had started as direct contracting, and that had been developed by this CMMI program. And very recently, that program, has in fact been changed. So I need to change this slide as well. It's now being called ACO REACH, Accountable Care Organization REACH program. Realizing, REACH stands for Realizing Equity, Access, and Community Health. Trying to make this program have a much more liberal sound to it. But frankly, it doesn't really change the principles that I describe here. It's, direct contracting entity is a group of physicians, an insurance company, or a private equity entity, and it tends to be the insurance company, or literally Wall Street, private equity, buying up a group of practitioners who are in the traditional Medicare program, not in Advantage, in the traditional program. And it enrolls these primary care physicians, all of whose Medicare primary care patients are assigned. They're not given the choice that Medicare Advantage patients are to go into this. They get into it because their doctor bought into it, essentially. And then Medicare gives a capitated payment to cover all those assigned patients, but that capitated payment doesn't go directly to the doctor. It goes to a middleman, right? And that middleman is, a private equity entity or an insurance company. And the only way that the patient can, in fact, get out of this arrangement is to find a doctor who isn't in one of these, DCEs or REACH programs. You're going to hear a lot more about this because REACH was just created literally, or the term was only created literally about 3 weeks ago. DCEs at least were created when Trump was around. And here we have the ACO REACH model. I did do something on that. Let's not dilate further. I think I've gotten you to understand that. So this leads to, a list of the guarantees of universal health insurance in Belgium, 45, all the way down to Taiwan in 1996. And it leads kind of to my first conclusion about the history of health insurance in the United States. Well, government-sponsored health insurance, frankly, when you think about it, in the world, is rather young. It's somewhere around 50 years old. That's not very old. It shouldn't be so hard, frankly, for us to get to a universal coverage system. So any questions about this history? I have to pay attention to time. Okay. Let's move on then to the second part of this talk, which was the macroeconomics. And what you see here is a slide that I got from an economics professor friend of mine. He said you can use it for any talk on economics. You'll notice no labeling on the X's at the ordinate, but things are always going up. So where do we spend our money in healthcare? And what I've decided to do is to compare pre-Medicare Medicaid 1960 with 2020, and you might say, oh my God, come on, fine, we're 2022, you're way behind schedule here. But this data for 2020 comes from Health Affairs, and was printed only in the January 2022 issue of Health Affairs. So they feel that the only way they can get, you know, really accurate data is to wait the 2 years to actually get it. And what you see here is that total national health expenditures go from $27 billion up to $400 trillion in that period from 1960 to 2020. That is what, 60 years, right? And we go from the national health expenditures as a percent of GDP, about 5% back in 1960, now 19.7%. That's the official number from Health Affairs. And then look at where we spend it. In 1960, we spent 85% of it on personal health care. And in 2020, roughly the same amount, 81%. What in the world is personal health care? Any ideas? What do you think is in there?
We are doctors.
Doctors, okay, absolutely. Doctors, nurse practitioners, people that practice outpatient and inpatient medicine, and
also drugs and imaging.
Drugs. Absolutely correct.
And imaging probably really expensive too.
Yeah, true, but that's probably embedded within hospitals or within outpatient radiology labs and so on. So it's not really a separate category. Anything else? So hospitals, physicians, drugs, nursing homes. Or long-term care in general.
Is dental and mental in here too?
Dental and mental is there, but it's, you'll see, I have it on the next slide where we break these out much more. See, public health activities, there is at least a little bit more spent there. Research and constructions come down a bit. The per capita expenditure, I think, again, is interesting, going from $147 to over $12,000 per person. And when you break this down, what you see is that hospital care consumes roughly close to 40%, 39% in 1960, 38% in 2020. Physician services have gone from 23 to 24%. Dental, oh my God, what happened to the poor dentists? From 9% down to 4%. One reason probably is, there is very little good dental insurance, but you should be clear that the dentists are doing very well. 4% of $4 trillion is still a large amount of money. Prescription drugs, I've always been surprised about this, that it's roughly, 11%, 10%. Other medical products, interestingly, have gone down. I don't know why that is. Nursing home and home health care has gone way up. Why is that?
People are living longer.
People are living longer. So, yeah, that's usually the answer we all give. But this talk is about insurance. And the fascinating thing about this is that there is a insurance that is now used for nursing home care because Medicare doesn't cover nursing homes except for 20 days after a hospitalization. But what's the other program that covers nursing home care?
Medicaid.
And many middle class people will spend down to the eligibility level on Medicaid in order to get this benefit when they are no longer able to live independently. So, you get the general thrust here. The question is, where do we get all this money from? And there are two major sources. One is a public source, like Medicare, Medicaid, CHIP, and so on. And the other is a private source, namely private health insurance, out-of-pocket payouts. Which do you think is more, public or private?
Public.
Public? Really? Now, if you read the New York Times, that's not what they would say. Or if you read the New England Journal, interestingly, it's not what they would say. But I think you're right. That indeed, when you look at it, private funds really, I think, make up about one third, a little more than one third, of the sources of funds. And public funds are close to two thirds of sources. How is that possible? Well, and why is my calculation different from the New York Times and so on? Little debate about Medicare, 20%. Little debate about Medicaid and CHIP, 16%. Other federal programs, you know, the VA, the Department of Defense, the Child Health Insurance Program, other federal and state, little debate about that. The Indian Health Service, Federal Public Health, Workers' Comp, SAMHSA, School Health, COVID-19. But it's these last two categories that actually most people don't call public funding. Public employee health insurance. Who pays for the mayor and the garbage collector's health insurance?
Taxes.
We do taxes, exactly, right? And the calculation about the private health insurance subsidies that corporations are able to get because they provide private health insurance amount to this 5% and this 7%. And therefore, I took those out of private health insurance. Because even though what happens is that the mayor and the garbage collector buy their health insurance in the private sector, frankly, it's you and I that are supporting it. Private health insurance is heavily subsidized by us. Any questions about this? It leads to my second conclusion, however, that we are more than halfway to a government financed healthcare system. It shouldn't be so hard for us to actually get to a predominantly publicly financed system and guarantee access to everybody. So, let's now turn. Oh, and then these numbers here, just interesting, comparing to other industrialized nations. This is their private and public expenditure, and as the two-thirds that we just talked about here is roughly equal to what is done in those countries. So, all right. For this segment, I find it helpful if you all are able to take some notes comparing. So here we are. We're going to compare, as you can see, the three dominant forms of health insurance, and I've also put in private health insurance just through the exchanges, the ACA, the fourth category. So let's start briefly, just so that you have a sense of it. How many people are actually enrolled in Medicare, Medicaid, and private health insurance? Which do you think is the largest of those three? In terms of the number of people who have that health insurance.
My Medicare?
Medicare you think is the largest. Okay.
Private employer.
Private employer-based health insurance is technically the largest, and we'll get to that. It's about 135 million people. Medicaid is second, interestingly, at about 77 million. And Medicare, closer to roughly, let's see, I think 61 million. And Medicare Advantage is 38% of that 61 million people. Okay. What's the eligibility for Medicare? We'll just go quickly around this.
65.
Gotta be 65. And in addition to that, you've had to work and contribute to the program through your tax deductions for 40 quarters. How many years is that? Pardon?
10
years. Pretty simple, right? Yeah. And what is happening, you're now contributing to it already. You're contributing 1.45% of your payroll tax, your payroll, and your employer is putting in 1.45% for 2.9% is being taken out of your paycheck. And there are now people under 65, this was not passed in 65, it turns out it was 1972, people under 65 that can also get Medicare. Who are they? People with ESRD, what is that? End-stage renal disease, and people on dialysis, and people who are permanently disabled. And what that means is that they have to be disabled, unable to work for 2 years. Pauses all, results in all sorts of problems. Because what are they, how do they survive for the 2 years that they are totally disabled? But that's the rule. Is Medicare a means-based program? What do I mean by that? Is it a GER-angry program? No. How do you measure a means-based program? Based on income. Okay. Is it a means-based program? Absolutely not. Sanford Weill, you all know who he is, right? No poor person. He uses Medicare, you bet he does. So, the wealthy and the poor can use this, it is not means-based. In terms of coverage, what benefits do you think it covers? Inpatient, yes. Outpatient, no, yes. Prescription drugs, huge gap. Nursing home care, fundamentally, no. What are the deductibles? For the Part A, that is to say the hospitalization, it's now $1,556. For Part B, you have to spend $233 out of pocket before the benefit kicks in. For Part D, it varies depending on the prescription drug benefit company. Some, there's no deductible. Others can be as high as $480, but not higher. Okay. What about co-payments? For the Medicare program on the inpatient side, it's a 80-20 program. Okay. 80% is paid by Medicare, and 20% is out of pocket. That's why people do what? Buy supplemental insurance. Okay, because otherwise this you know, given the way hospital bills can be $10,000 to $100,000, this becomes an intolerable burden on the person. So they buy supplemental insurance to cover it. And if you stay in the hospital over 61 to 90 days, you will be charged an additional $352 per day. And if it's over 90 days, $704. You may say, well, this is totally irrelevant. How many people have a patient that stays over 90 days in the hospital? You have some. That's amazing.
We have lots.
You have lots. That's fascinating to me. It just shows that I haven't been on the inpatient service for a few years. But when I was at Columbia, I had a patient who was there for 2.5 years, 3 years. So it does happen. What is the actuarial value? That is to say, what is the real dollar value that the insurance here pays for? It's essentially 80%, because this is an 80-20 program. And what is the type of financing called? Part A is essentially payroll taxes, as we described, 2.9%. Part B and D have premiums. Part B, the premium that you pay when you retire can be $148.50 per month, or $1,700 per year. And for Part D, it can be anywhere from $15 to $95 per month. Is this progressive financing? If we look really at, you know, that 2.9%, it's the same irrespective of your income, right? So that's what Sandy Weill would be paying, but also, you know, what some poor secretary or something is paying. So it's not, in fact, a progressive form of financing. It's a flat tax.
I'd say it's even worse because it's actually capped. So income above a certain level is...
But not anymore, as I understand it. Social Security is capped at $147,000. But Medicare used to be capped, but they took the cap away a few years ago.
Thank you.
So now the income is all the way up. Administrative costs of Medicare. Actually, it's quite inexpensive as a program because, you know, essentially of the dollars collected, roughly 97 to 98% of that money goes to pay doctors, hospitals, prescription drugs, and only 2 or 3% is for the running of the program. How are doctors paid on Medicare? Most of it is traditional fee-for-service. It's become a little bit more complicated with the MACRA program and the pay-for-performance program, where you can have money deducted because you don't have people getting flu shots, things of that sort. And what is the network narrowness? Well, for hospitals, hospitals, almost 100% of them take Medicare. But physicians, about 91%. And if I mentioned this earlier, the predominant number of physicians who don't take Medicare at all live right here on the Upper East Side of Manhattan because it's such a wealthy community. All right, any questions about Medicare? Let's move quickly to Medicaid. 76 million are on Medicaid, 7 million on CHIP, 9 million in the Veterans Administration. What's the eligibility? We talked about this. There are you know, 50 different eligibility criteria in the country. Why is that? Because each state is able to suggest, you know, to deal with the eligibility as a percent of income, right? Is this a means-based program? Is it based on income? Yes, by definition. And in terms of comprehensiveness of benefits, does it cover inpatient care? Yes. Outpatient care? Yes. Prescription drugs? Yes. And nursing home. It is the most comprehensive health insurance program in the United States. Are there any deductibles? No, not in the Medicaid program. Co-payments, by and large, again, determined by the states. But in our state, we now may, some of you may experience this with some of your patients, that they're being asked to pay $1 for each generic prescription and $3 for a brand name. Somehow, this was not universally applied when I was, you know, seeing patients, so I don't know why that is. The actuarial value clearly is going to be different than Medicare, probably about 97%, so that, you know, essentially the program has really low administrative costs. And the type of financing, it's from general tax revenues. GTR stands for general tax revenues. And that would be the way the federal program is funded. And in this state, the feds provide 50% of the cost, whereas the state and the counties provide 50%. General tax revenues, is this a progressive form of financing? Yeah, the income tax is, you know, and to some degree corporate taxes. So it is progressive. Administrative costs of running the Medicaid program, rather, is it going to be more than Medicare? Yeah, it might be a little more. Why? Because you have to judge the income eligibility of the patient every year. Whereas in the Medicare program, you can be 65 how often? You can be permanently disabled how often? So you get the general sense. You don't need as much administrative, you know, judging, of eligibility. So it's about 5 to 6% administrative cost. How are doctors paid on Medicare? Medicaid rather. It's heavily managed care these days. So that what happens is that the insurance company, sets a capitated amount of money. It's not based so much, it's like per member per month. If you were in private practice, that's what you would be getting, is a fixed amount of money, irrespective of the number of visits the patient made to you, capitated amount. And what is the network for Medicaid? Anyone have a sense? Pardon?
Not enough of their specialists.
Indeed, it's a narrow network. As you know, we have specialists that don't like to take Medicaid. Yeah. How am I doing? We're almost, 4 minutes. Okay. Let's go quickly through private health insurance. The number, 135 million, roughly. You know, you'll get different numbers here from different people depending on how they count them. But somewhere between 135 and 140 million. Eligibility is employment, usually. Is this a means-based program? Well, plus or minus, because you get a better program if you work for a huge company that's a wealthy company than, you know, if you're working for a mom and pop shop, which doesn't give you much. comprehensiveness of coverage, highly variable, depending on who? The employer, in this instance. And the deductibles can range from $1,500 is the average single person deductible for a family, $4,500. And yes, you can purchase high deductible programs up to $15,000. These are kind of called catastrophic programs where you would have much lower premiums. Co-payments, highly variable and dependent again on the employer and what he can or she can negotiate with the private insurance entity. Actuarial value, somewhere around 86% to 87%. Type of financing, premiums essentially for single people, we talked about this earlier, $7,470. The employer, that's what the employer puts in, and the employee, the family coverage is $21,000. Here the employee puts in $5,000. Those numbers make sense, yes. Progressive financing, no, fundamentally this is really regressive because the premium that's paid is the same for the president and the secretary. Administrative costs, anywhere between 16% and 30%. Payment to doctors, frequently to PPOs, preferred provider organizations, or what we call indemnity payment, which is a fee-for-service form of payment, and network narrowness, highly variable, but somewhat dependent really on the employer who decides, you know, what kind of insurance to get. And you can get health insurance in New York, for instance, that will not cover coming into New York Presbyterian, but only cover going to Mount Sinai, you know, so that's variable. And then finally, for the private health insurance exchange-based programs, roughly 13 million nationwide, eligibility is between 138 and 400% of the poverty level. Means-based, yes. Benefits, variable, but in this instance dependent on the insurer because there's no employer. This is where the individual is buying health insurance in this market. Deductibles, here as you know, are these things, the alphabet stands for platinum, gold, silver, bronze, catastrophic. So a platinum plan, you know, has no deductibles, probably very little co-payments, and so on, but is very much more expensive, okay? And then when you get down to co-payments, what you see here is the platinum plan is probably $15 for primary care, $35 for a specialist. You know, the gold plan, 25, 40, the silver plan, 30 to 50, and a bronze plan, you're paying 50% out of pocket. The actuarial value will obviously depend on whether it's a platinum plan, you know, or a bronze plan, 60 to 90%. Type of financing is premiums, variable by income. Progressive financing, yes, the tax credits are progressive, as you will see. Administrative costs, anywhere from 15% to 20%. Physician payment, fee for service, or per member per month. And a network narrowness, variable, again, depending on the insurer, not on the employer, because the employer's not involved. So, any questions about these things? Let me just show you very quickly. Here's the federal poverty guidelines, so you get a sense of how it varies, you know, depending on whether it's 100% of the federal poverty level, 133, 138, 250, or 400%. And then what you get here, these are back to 2015 when I got this data. If you're a single individual with an annual income essentially around the 138% of poverty, back then it was 16.5, now it's 17 something. Right? And here you have two kinds of insurance companies, Health First and Empire. And you look at the bronze plans, the one that isn't the greatest in terms of coverage. What you see here is the premium to the tax credit per month is the same for every plan, but you get something that would be attractive to an individual who has 139% of the poverty level income. They would only be paying $7.12 for a Health First coverage. But if they're going to get Empire, they're going to only get 81, they're going to have to pay 81.27 in order to get the difference between this, the premium, and the tax credit per month. You know, and if you go up to a platinum plan, you can see they're paying quite substantial amounts of money. And this one is 300% of poverty and just gives you an idea that the tax credit really goes down as the person's income presumably goes up. And then it's true for things like hospital, you know, deductibles, inpatient cost sharing, outpatient cost sharing, emergency rooms, so on. Physician services, co-payments, you see how they work. So, all of this leads to my last conclusion, right? Health insurance in the United States is excessively complicated. Multiple payers, I think, add no value. Administrative costs of private health insurance are much too high. Deductibles and co-payments shift costs to patients. There is, frankly, I think, an epidemic in this country, not just of COVID, but of underinsurance, and it's increasing. We need to hear from Dr. Auerbach. So, we'll stop there. And are we right at 3 o'clock?